And this is the new seminar of the De Cifrisia Thesis series. Federico Mazzone is a student in our master course in mathematics, major in cryptography. He's also a student of Percorso d'Eccellenza, which is a selected group of students who have special duties and special grants. And I will talk about polymorphic encryption, which is an interesting system related to cloud encryption, but recently it has found a new interesting use in different applications, and in particular, Federico will talk us about shared conversion protocol. Please, Federico.
Okay. Welcome, everyone, again. Thanks, Professor Sala, for the introduction. Today, we will talk about a particular type of encryption system, the homomorphic ciphers. The peculiarity of this system, and this is the why I took them here to you, as the name says, lies in the homomorphic properties of the encryption function. Namely, the encryption function behaves well in some way that we will define better later with the sum and the scalar product of the plaintext. I imagine that you can already guess what I mean with behaves well, but we will define it more formally. To immediately give you an idea of how useful the homomorphic ciphers can be in practice, we will start the seminar by talking about a really interesting application in the use of homomorphic properties. We can use them to build a so-called shared conversion protocol. We will describe this protocol, how it can be used in practice, and we will be briefly analyzing the most important aspect of correctness and of security. And we will note that there is a kind of trade-off in this particular case. During the second half of the seminar, we are going to present one of such homomorphic encryption schemes that led to the construction of a conversion protocol. And this scheme is made by Pascal Payet. We are going to talk about the basic concepts that we will need in order to understand the crypto system by Payet, and the construction of the cipher will result almost natural just by following a chain of definition, lemmas, and proof that we are going to see. We will not discuss most of the proofs here just because of time, and a part of one or two proofs that I found particularly interesting and useful in order to construct the cipher. For those who are interested in the other proof, I leave the link to the original paper by Pascal at the end of the slides. What else? We will also mention something about the security of the Pascal Payet cipher. And if we have enough time, we will discuss some implementation idea that can make the cipher a little bit faster. Well, let's start with part one. We consider the context of a secret sharing scheme. So we have two actors, Alice and Bob, and they have a share. Both of them have one share, one private share of a common secret, X, in a multiplicative form. So X is of the form A times B mod a given prime Q. Usually you can imagine that this prime is very, very big. Then what's the purpose of the protocol we are going to present? The purpose is to convert these two private shares from a multiplicative form to an additive form. Namely, we want Alice and Bob to interact with each other in order to transform A and B into alpha and beta, such that the secret is alpha plus beta, always mod Q, our prime. And the problem, obviously, is that during this protocol, none of the actor should guess anything about the original private shares that the other actor had. So, let's start. These are the assumptions that I just told you. Then what we need is an additively homomorphic scheme, encryption scheme, And we assume that Alice has a public key associated to this home scheme. We need some definition to use the morphic properties. Namely, we can assume that there exists two operation in the ciphertext domain. We denote them with plus E and times E. And these two operations respect these two properties. Namely, the decryption of the sum of the ciphertext corresponds to the sum of the original plaintext. And the same for the scalar product. Then another thing we need for this conversion share protocol is a constant K that we will discuss later what it is used for. And it must respect these true bounds. If it can help you to follow better the description of the protocol, you can imagine that K, the dimension of K is about Q to the power of 3, more or less. So if Q is 256 bits, then K is about 768 bits or something like that. And N, you can just use the bound, and so it must be at least something like Q to the 8, so 2048 bits, just to give you an idea of the order of the various elements. Then let's see the protocol. This is the protocol flowchart. We start with Alice, who encrypts a private share A using the homomorphic encryption and sends the ciphertext to Bob. For the moment, just ignore the dashed lines. We will discuss them later. Then Bob chooses a beta prime randomly in the integers mod n, and he encrypts the following using the homomorphic properties. If you note, what is this quantity? Well, CA is the ciphertext corresponding to Alice's private share. So using the homomorphic properties, this is the encryption of B times A. Then we sum always with the homomorphic properties with the encryption of beta prime. Bob can also encrypt because the public key is public indeed. So this corresponds to the encryption of B times A plus beta prime. Then Bob sends this quantity to Alice, who is able to decrypt, because we are assuming that Alice has the public key and also the private key for her public key. She decrypts the quantity, and then the most natural choice for alpha and beta is to use beta as minus beta prime. So we have B times A minus beta, and Alice just denotes this quantity as alpha. So if you take beta on the other side, we have alpha plus beta is equal to A times B. And you would say, nice, this is done. Not really. If we are very careful, we note that we have a problem. Indeed, what is the problem? That the cipher does not work mod Q. Indeed, this operation and this identity is mod n, the modulus of the cipher. And we want the identity in the two holds mod q, which is less than n by the hypothesis of the bound we saw before. So what's about this? We just say that the protocol is not correct. But don't worry, we can see that the protocol is not correct just with a really low probability. Indeed, when this ensure correctness? Well, when the mod operation does not apply. So when the mod operation does not apply, when AB plus beta prime does not exceed the M bound. So let's just compute the probability of the event that this does not happen. What's the probability that choosing beta prime randomly mod n, it will oversee the n minus ab? Then we just exploit the uniform distribution. Then we use the bound that we created at the beginning. And we will note that the probability that the protocol fails, so that it is not correct, is less than 1 over Q, where Q is our very large prime. So we can see, we can say that the protocol is almost surely correct. Then let's discuss about the security of the protocol. Well, from this point of view, we have nothing to complain about. Indeed, the protocol is totally secure. The only messages that are sent from Alice to Bob and from Bob to Alice are these two. Alice sent to Bob the encryption of her private share. And if we assume that the encryption system is at least semantically secure, then Bob cannot guess anything about the original plaintext. From his point of view, this will just be noise, random number. So this first message is secure. It does not give any problem. What about the second message, the one from Bob to Alice? Well, Bob computed this quantity, as we saw before, just by using homomorphic properties. And then Alice is able to decrypt them. So Alice is able to get B times A, B times A plus beta prime. So she could have some chances to get B, the private share of Bob. But this is not possible because there is this translation. This is a number taken randomly in the integers modem, where n is the greatest between the three variables we are using. So this acts like noise, and the whole quantity can just be a random elements. Alice is not able to reverse this translation. And so this ensures even the security from the point of view of Bob. Do you remember that I told you to ignore the two dashed lines? Well, that they were just two zero knowledge proofs. In particular, they were two range proofs that both Alice and Bob had to perform in order to guarantee to the other actor that their private share, the private share that they were using, is actually at least less than our fixed constant k. Indeed, what are these zero knowledge proofs used for? Well, as we have seen here, they are not used for security as someone could expect from a zero knowledge proof. But they are used to ensure that almost surely correctness. Indeed, what an adversary could do if there were not these true zero knowledge proofs? But it could just have used a private share that is not really less than Q, or less than K at least. And if it does not do that, then we have not the bound that A and B are less than K, and all the probability computation that we have done before fails. And why an adversary would what he could gain from making just the protocol fail without getting any information from for the other one's private share? Well, this could happen in more practical cases where maybe this conversion protocol can be a part of a bigger protocol that checks whether or not this subroutine works. And the adversary could exploit this knowledge to get some information, at least about the range where the private share of the other actor stays, because he could use as a fake share something as big as n, or a little bit less, and just try many of them to see whether the protocol fails or not. And using this many times, it can at least shorten the range of the other one's share. Oh, another important remark is what we said about the almost surely correctness. Indeed, someone could just ask himself, well, why don't you just choose a beta prime in a different range? so that the quantity A times B plus beta prime does not exceed N. This can be done. You can just shorten the range where beta prime is chosen, so that it ensures that that quantity will never exceed N. And this would guarantee the correctness of the protocol. But we will lose something. Indeed, the distribution of beta prime will not be uniform anymore in the integers mod N. So it won't guarantee the security anymore, but since K is usually taken a lot smaller than N, usually K is Q to the 3 and N is Q to the power of 8, so we can anyway say that this variant of the protocol is correct and not secure, but anyway statistically secure. And just this, it was a nice variant to see. The last two remarks are not so important. We will see them later if we still have time. I would prefer to go on with the second part. We describe the Paillet homomorphic encryption scheme. So let's start with the theoretical part. We need to choose two big primes, P and Q, such that they respect the usual characteristics to be RSA primes. So too big, very big, to be of the same length, to be safe primes, etc. This will be needed for the properties that we will see. Then we define lambda as the Carmichael function applied to N. So in this case, since N is P times Q, it will be the least common multiple between P minus 1 and Q minus 1. Note that for the assumption that PQ are RSA prime, we get that these divisions are not possible. And a consequence that you can easily prove is that the quantity N is coprime both with phi of N and with lambda. And this will be used quite everywhere in the next few slides. So keep this in mind. Then let's just remember some definition. We consider the field of the integers mod n square, the invertibles associated to this ring. And this will be the field where we are going to work for the next 30 minutes, I think. Let's remember the definition of being an nth residue. An nth residue mod n square in this case is just an element that admits an nth root. So an element z such that there exists y that y to the power of n is z. You can easily prove that the set of all the nth residues form a multiplicative subgroup of our field and its order is phi of n. Keep this in mind. And if you want, to prove it, you can just consider the homomorphism to the field that from the field to the field that send an element z to z to the power of n, and look at what it is its kernel, and just use the cardinality. Let's define what is the problem of CR of n. We will use this later. Indeed. To decide whether a given element z is an nth residue or not, it is not so easy. And we will call the problem of distinguish between nth residues and not nth residues by CR of n. Now, let's go on. We fix an element g in our field, and we concede this map. This map take a pair xy, and sends it into this element of our field, g to the power of x times y to the power of n. What's the peculiarity of this map? Well, if we choose the element g in a smart way, indeed, if we choose g such that its order is a multiple, non-trivial multiple of n, then you can easily prove that this map is bijective. And if this map is bijective, it means that for every w that we consider in our field, we can uniquely associate a unique pair in the domain such that the pair is sent into SW. And so if we focus in particular on the first component of the pair, it will be very useful. And so we are going to define and denote it as the nth reciprocity class of W with respect to G, where W is the element that we chose in our field. We will denote it with these double square brackets. You can prove that the reciprocity class, the reciprocity class of W has two interesting properties. First, the reciprocity class of an element W is zero if and only if this element is an nth residue mod n squared. Well, you can see this very easily because if x is zero, then this quantity just becomes y to the n, and so it is a residue. And on the contrary, if you assume that this is an nth residue, then you can just use the power of phi of n, this will be deleted, and then you can exploit the fact that n is coprime with phi of n, and the hypothesis that g has ordered a multiple, non-trivial multiple of n, and you would get the result. The second point of lemma, I guess it will be a little bit of a spoiler of what will be the encryption function of pi here. Indeed, we can observe that the reciprocity class, seen as a map from the field to the integers mod n, is an homomorphism. So it respects this rule, and you can just see it by look that the class is just the exponent of G. And so obviously it becomes from multiplicative to additive. The fact that we notice that the function we defined is bijective and so it is an inverse does not mean that the inverse is easy to compute. Indeed, computing the pair xy that is sent into our element w, and in particular to compute x, is not an easy problem. And we defined this problem as class of ng. And more formally, this is the problem of computing the class of W with respect to G, given certain W, G, and N. Let's note two interesting facts. Indeed, we can note that this problem is not the hardness of this problem is not related nor on W and nor on G. We can formally say that the problem is a random self-reducible both on over W and both over G. In easy words, it means that there is no worst case scenario. The worst case scenario just is equal to the average scenario. And I left you some hint to prove it. The idea behind these two proofs is just that you take a generic W and you assume that you are able to solve the problem class over this W, and then you just make a polynomial time transformation of the problem to solve a generic W. And the hint is to use this transformation because it will lead to the computation of the generic W just as the class of our fixed W plus the alpha. And a similar trick can be done for the random self-reducibility over G. We have to use some more tricky formulas, but at the end, we can convert the computation of the class over G1 into the computation over two classes, but both over another G2. These two lemmas are telling us that class NG is not really a problem on W and on G. So we can just see it as a computational problem on N, and we will denote it by class of N. This problem is fundamental in order to build the decryption function of the Paillet cryptosystem. In particular, in order to build it, we are going to see one result that relates the problem of class N to another famous problem, the problem of factorizing n. In particular, we can prove that the problem class n can be polynomially reduced to the problem of factorization of n. In other words, if we are able to factorize n, then we are able to resolve the problem class n, indeed give a w to compute its residuosity class. In order to prove this theorem, and its proof will be fundamental, we need some intermediate definition results. First, we define this function, L of u, as the integer quotient of the long division of u minus 1 by n, where u is the argument. And this is just a technical lemma that puts in relation w, or at least a transformation of w, with the residuosity class of w. If you want this, the proof of this lemma is just technical. You go straight on, and you can find it on the paper of Paillet. It's not so interesting. The proof of this theorem, indeed, is very interesting. Let's just omit some details that is not so relevant, but the core of the proof is to build a closed formula that relates what we know, or at least what we know from factorizing n, to the construction of our residuosity class w. Indeed, we can note that applying the lemma with w equals to g, then we have that this quantity is equal to lambda and the class times the class of g with respect to n plus 1. Using some tricks that we could already notice proving the dilemma before, you can just go and prove that this quantity is invertible. And so we can define this fraction. If you go on and simplify the fraction, then you can just get to this. And just by using the translation of residuosity class, this is equal to the class of w with respect to g. If you wanted to see this step more carefully, I would suggest you just to take this on this side, and it should be more clear. Now, what can we do with this closed formula? Well, we have a way to compute the residuosity class of w with respect to g. But what do we need in order to compute this? Well, let's analyze this quantity. We have L, which is known, because other than the parameter, it just depends on N, which is public. Then we have W, which is what we are looking at the class for. Then we have N again, which is public. Then we have G, which is the fixed element. The only thing that we do not know is lambda. Indeed, what do we need in order to compute lambda? Yeah, the factorization of N. Because if we know P and Q, then we are just able to compute lambda as the least common multiple of P minus 1 and Q minus 1. So we solved the theorem. We just proved that if we are able to factorize N, we are able to compute lambda, and so we are able to compute the residuosity class of W. Okay, we are quite done with the theoretical part before the cipher. We just sum up the results we have seen so far about the problems and the relative conjectures. Well, this we have already seen this polynomial reduction. This is the decisional problem associated to the computational problem. So if this is the problem of computing the class of W given a certain W, this is the problem of given W and given X, tell me whether or not X is the residuosity class of W. And obviously this is easier than the computational problem. And this is the problem that we saw at the beginning. So the problem of deciding whether or not something is an F residue, mod N squared. If you look between these two problems, you would see that these problems are polynomially equivalent. Indeed, you can prove that if you are able to solve one of them, then with a few computation, you are even able to solve the other. Indeed, just let's make one of the show. If we are able to tell whether or not X is the class, the reciprocity class of W, then if we have Z and we want to know if it is an nth residue, we just ask the oracle whether or not zero is the reciprocity class of our Z, because we saw it in the lemma of some slides ago, that something has class zero if and only if it is an nth residue. The other implication is trivial in the same way. Just ask whether or not W times G to the power of minus X is an nth residue. If it is, just take this quantity to the other side. Then let's sum up the two conjectures that we could make about these problems. The first one involves these two problems that, since they are equivalent, they just have one conjecture. And we can say that we assume that there exists no polynomial time algorithm that can decide one of these two problems. And then we assume another conjecture, the computational one, and that we have no polynomial time algorithm which is able to compute the class of a given W. These two conjectures will be fundamental to analyze the security of the Pi-Li-A crypto system. For those who are interested, we can even relate the problem we saw with the RSA problem. In particular, we can see that the RSA problem NN, which means the problem of extracting nth root mod N, which is a particular case of RSA, is most difficult of class of N, and obviously it is easier than factorizing N. Then you can have a generalization of RSA NN, which is a RSA EN, that is the standard RSA, so extracting if roof of mod N, that is just the decryption. What else? Then we finally can start describing the Pi-Li-A encryption scheme. We just sum up what we already said, as I told you at the beginning. The building is natural. We choose two primes, P and Q, that satisfy all the properties. Then we compute N and our Carmichael function lambda. We define the function of a long-term division quotient. We choose G in our field such that its order is a multiple of N, and we didn't prove it, but you can prove that a sufficient condition to test this property is just to test if this quantity admits an inverse. If you go back in the slides, you would see that we proved this implication, so that if we have G such that the order is a multiple of N, then this condition is true, but you can also prove the contrary. Then the key generation is done, because our public key will be N and the random G, and while our private key will just be the factorization of N and the lambda, but it can be computed from the factorization. What about the encryption? The encryption, as you may have guessed since the lemma, is just the map that we defined. But remember that the map we defined took a pair. And what do we use as a pair? Obviously, the first component of the pair will be our message, so that it will guarantee the security. For the second component of the pair, we can use a random quantity. Maybe I should have used the invertibles here. Sorry, there is a typo. But well, the probability to not take an invertible here is very low. And then this is just the encryption. What about the decryption indeed? As I already told you, the decryption is based on the proof of the theorem that class of n can be polynomially reduced to the factorization. This is the closed formula that we saw in the proof. So we have our ciphertext C, and we just compute the reciprocity class of C. That for how we defined C is just M. Let's go on about the monomorphic properties. Well, we already saw them in the lemma, and they just derive from the fact that we choose this as an encryption function. But let's just show them better. We can define the true operation on the ciphertext domain as the sum, obviously, must become the multiplication between ciphertext, and the scalar product will become the power elevation to the scalar. And then it will obviously satisfy the two properties that we are asking for any homomorphic encryption system because of the lemma that we saw before. Let's analyze the security. This is much more interesting. Well, we will go on starting from a really low level request for security. And we will start with the one-way encryption level. This is the lowest level you can ask. Indeed, for a public key encryption system, we say that it has a one-way encryption if and only if an attacker that is given a random ciphertext is not able to recover the corresponding plaintext in its entirety. This is not a so powerful request because the requirement is that the attacker is not able to recover 100% of information about the plaintext. So if he would be able to guess, for example, 99th bits over 100, we would still say that it is a one-way encryption safe. Anyway, what's the corresponding conjectures for this security request? Well, you may have guessed it. It's just the computational assumption. Indeed, it is equivalent. Here we are asking that from the ciphertext, we are not able to go back to the plaintext. But what was the ciphertext? The ciphertext was just the image of the plaintext and the random quantity through the map that we defined. So if we are not able to go back, then we are not able to go from the ciphertext to the plaintext. Then let's go on with a higher level of security, the semantic security. In other words, the resistance again chosen plaintext attacker. Let's define it formally for who is not very expert about security stuff. We define that a schema is semantically secure if the following game does not give any advantage to a possible attacker. We have an attacker, and this attacker can choose two plaintext, let's say M0 and M1. And from the other side, we have an oracle, and this oracle is able to encrypt using the Paillet encryption system. The oracle will choose randomly between one of these two plaintext, and it will encrypt it and sends it back to the attacker. If the attacker is not able to say which of the two plaintext the oracle chose with a probability higher than 50%, then we will say that the encryption system is semantically secure. And what is the conjecture that will assure us to have semantic security? Well, for example, if the attacker would be able to decide whether M0 is or not the plain text corresponding to CB, he would have a 100% chance to get the answer. So the conjectures related to this level of security is the decisional assumption. Indeed, if the attacker is able to ask to another oracle, is M0 the plain text corresponding to CB? Yes, then it will choose B equal to 0. No, then it will choose B equal to 1. Let's make an IA request and ask if whether or not the PyA crypto system is secure against even chosen ciphertext attack. What is a chosen ciphertext attack? Then we can formally define it like the semantic security resistance, but we add one more step. Indeed, before the attacker, before guessing B, is able to perform one more action. He can choose a finite number of ciphertexts. Obviously, he cannot choose the one that he received from the oracle. And he can send them back to the oracle, who must decrypt them and send the decryption to the attacker. And now the attacker must guess whether B was 0 or was 1. Then PyA crypto system is chosen ciphertext resistant? No, it is not. Indeed, we can exploit the homomorphic properties to make this trick. We can, the attacker can choose C0, for example, as two times CB in the sense of homomorphic operation. So this would be CB to the power of 2. And when this is obviously, in general, it is not equal to, it is not equal to CB, so it is a fair choice, and the oracle will just decrypt it as two times the original plaintext. Then the attacker can just can simply invert true mod n, and he would get the plaintext. Note one thing, this kind of example is not just related to PyA crypto system. This is a more general fact. We just use the homomorphic properties. So this means that in general, any kind of homomorphic public key crypto system is not able to resist to chosen ciphertext attack. Then if we still have enough time, I would like to tell you something about a few implementation ideas that can be used to speed up a possible implementation of a PyA crypto system. Yeah, we have some minutes. Then let's start with the encryption function. I remember you that the encryption function is just the map that we defined. So it takes the plaintext, it makes G to the power of the plaintext, or maybe a transformation of the original plaintext, and then it makes it times a random quantity to the power of N. What can we do to make a possible implementation faster? Well, obviously we can make the choice of G small. If we take a small G, then this computation that it is one of the most expensive ones will take less. Another more subtle choice would be to make some pre-processing techniques on the computation of this power. Indeed, we could store some of the true powers of G. We can store G to the power of 2, G to the powers 4, and so on. And then we could just assemble the powers that we got to get to the power of N. Another thing is that usually if we put this cipher inside this crypto system, inside an application context, usually there will be times where one of the actors is not doing anything. There will be times where there are no computation, and so the one who wants to encrypt could just use these times to produce random quantities in advance and already compute R to the power of N. so that when will be the time to perform the encryption, this quantity is already computed. From the other side, we can even work on the decryption function. For example, this quantity is the same for all the decryption. Indeed, it does not depend on the ciphertext, so we can compute this once for all. Then we can use a subtle trick to make the computation of the quotient inside of L faster. We can make, instead of making a division, we can transform it into multiplication if we change the ring we are working on. So instead of working mod n, we can work on 2 to the power of the length of n and transform it to a multiplication by the inverse of n inside this ring. But I saw that in quite no implementation there has been this trick. Then we have one famous way to speed up the process. We are working in mod n. So a classical thing, when you work mod p times q, you just work mod p, mod q, and then you use the Chinese remainder theorem to put the results together. This is even done in RSA crypto system, for example. I think we are done, yes? Then thank you for your attention.